From San Francisco, this is Democracy Now!
You're risking your life here.
It's exactly what's going on.
And how much do you make?
$1 an hour.
Some have called it slave labor. What do you think of that?
No matter if we're incarcerated or we're free, we're getting paid $1 an hour.
As California faces a record-setting fire season, 20% of the firefighters battling the wildfires are prisoners. They're being paid just $1 an hour, saving the state up to $100 million a year. Is this a modern-day form of slave labor? We'll travel to a California prison fire camp to speak to some of the incarcerated firefighters. Then to death on the Dakota Access Pipeline.
I uncovered two deaths that occurred during the construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline. That then led me to an investigation that found that the building of oil and natural gas pipelines is one of the deadliest jobs in America.
We'll speak with investigative journalist Antonia Yuhas. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The storm of a lifetime. That's how one National Weather Service meteorologist is describing the massive Category 4 Hurricane Florence, currently barreling toward the coast of the Carolinas, slated to make landfall Friday. The National Hurricane Center is warning of a life-threatening storm surge, as well as massive flooding and highly destructive winds. This is North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper.
This storm is a monster. It's big and it's vicious. It is an extremely dangerous, life-threatening, historic hurricane. That's why I'm ordering a mandatory state evacuation for our barrier islands. And I'm directing the people of North Carolina to obey local evacuation orders that have already been issued and will be issued along our coast.
More than 1.5 million people have been ordered to evacuate North Carolina, South Carolina, and Virginia as Hurricane Florence approaches. Yet prison officials say they will not evacuate nearly 1,000 prisoners at the Ridgeland Correctional Institution in Jasper County, South Carolina. In Virginia, Hurricane Florence is bearing down on the site of the construction of a controversial gas pipeline, the Mountain Valley Pipeline, threatening to further pollute pristine waterways with erosion. Meanwhile, in neighboring North Carolina, experts are warning Hurricane Florence could kill thousands of farm animals and trigger catastrophic waste spills from sewage treatment plants, toxic coal ash ponds, hog waste lagoons, and chicken farms. Many of the factory hog farms in North Carolina store their waste by spraying it on nearby fields and neighborhoods or by depositing it in lagoons, which can overflow during hurricanes, causing the toxic pig manure to pour into nearby waterways. North Carolina is bracing for the climate change supercharged storm 6 years after passing legislation prohibiting state and local agencies from making planning decisions based on the latest climate science about sea level rise. Now the state is facing the threat of a life-threatening storm surge, which could cause billions of dollars in damage. On Tuesday, during an Oval Office briefing on Hurricane Florence, President Trump tried to celebrate his administration's response last year to Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico, which killed up to 3,000 people, if not more, making it the deadliest storm in U.S. history.
The job that FEMA and law enforcement and everybody did, working along with the governor in Puerto Rico, I think, was tremendous. I think that Puerto Rico was an incredible, unsung success.
Meanwhile, BuzzFeed is reporting FEMA has approved only 3% of requests for funeral assistance from Puerto Ricans who lost their loved ones during Hurricane Maria. As Hurricane Florence bears down on the East Coast, Senator Jeff Merkley has released documents showing the Trump administration took nearly $10 million from FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, and gave it to ICE the Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency, to build more jails. This is Senator Jeff Merkley speaking with MSNBC's Rachel Maddow.
The administration is working hard to find funds for additional detention camps. And, of course, this is all part of the child separation policy. And that's how this information came into my hands, because of my work on this issue of trying to stop the child separations. But, in fact, so $10 million comes out of FEMA when we're facing a hurricane season, knowing what happened last year.
This comes as the Health and Human Services Department says it'll triple the size of the tent camp where migrant children are imprisoned in the desert outside El Paso, Texas. The Trump administration established the tent camp in Tornillo in June as a temporary shelter amidst the administration's zero-tolerance policy, which included forcibly separating children from their parents. Officials say they're now expanding it to contain 3,800 beds for migrant children. Meanwhile, the former rabbi of White House advisor Stephen Miller, the architect of the family separation policy, condemned Miller in a fiery sermon during services for Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year. Rabbi Neil Comas Daniels of the Beth Shir Shalom in Santa Monica, California, said, quote, "From the Jewish perspective, the parent-child relationship is sacrosanct. Disrupting it is cruel. Mr. Miller, the policy you helped to conceive and put into practice is cruel," the rabbi said. Tens of thousands of Syrians have fled the northwest province of Idlib, the last major rebel-held territory in Syria, amidst fears the Syrian government will launch a full-out ground offensive. The United Nations has warned an offensive could lead to the worst loss of life in the 21st century. This is Ali al-Maimed, who fled from Idlib to the Turkish border.
What happened was destruction all over, burning, something you can't describe. It was strange. Military planes, rocket propellers, everything. They did not differentiate between civilians and others. There are no bases, nothing. They want to target civilians.
In Afghanistan, the death toll from Tuesday's suicide bombing in the eastern province of Nangarhar has risen to 68 people, with 165 more wounded. The attack came during a protest against a local police commander. No group has claimed responsibility for the attack so far. In Brazil, jailed former president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva has officially pulled out of the presidential race next month after a Supreme Court judge rejected his latest appeal and said he could not run from prison. Lula announced Tuesday he's stepping aside to allow his running mate, Fernando Haddad, to stand in his place. To see our full interview with the former president, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, go to democracynow.org. In Spain, up to 1 million people took to the streets of Barcelona Tuesday to celebrate Catalonia's National Day and to demand Catalonia's independence from Spain. Last October, the Spanish government seized control of Catalonia after its leaders held a banned independence referendum. And in the Horn of Africa, Ethiopia and Eritrea have reopened the border after 20 years following the two countries' signing of a historic peace deal in July. Hundreds of people have gathered at the two reopened border crossings to reunite with their friends and family members separated for 20 years by the war. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're broadcasting from San Francisco, the site of this week's Global Climate Action Summit. We begin today's show behind the scenes of California's raging climate-fueled wildfires with the hidden men and women on the front lines of the state's ever-growing fire season, prisoner firefighters. Of the 13,000 firefighters battling blazes across California, more than 2,500 are incarcerated. While salaried firefighters earn an annual mean wage of $74,000 a year plus benefits, prisoners earn $1 per hour when fighting active fires. According to some estimates, California saves up to $100 million a year by using prison labor to fight its biggest environmental problem. In August, California Governor Jerry Brown thanked the firefighters on the front lines, including those who are incarcerated.
You've heard there's a tremendous effort fighting these fires, and I want to I personally thank all the firefighters who are on the line, the members of CAL FIRE, also the National Guard, and the thousands of inmates who are also on the line fighting to protect lives and bring these fires to a quick close to the extent that's at all possible.
Incarcerated firefighters live in 44 low-security field camps throughout California, including three camps for women and one for juveniles. They're routinely called upon to fight the state's most dangerous fires. In the last year alone, the state has seen the largest fire in California history, the Mendocino Complex fire, and the most destructive, the Tubbs fire in 2017, which killed 24 people and destroyed more than 5,600 homes. In 2017, prisoner firefighters spent 4 million hours on active fires. As climate change leads to longer and more dangerous fire seasons in California, and the state's firefighting agency, CAL FIRE, is running out of money, California is increasingly relying on its prisoner fire force to combat wildfires. Prison firefighters earn time off of their sentences for good behavior, typically 2 days off for each day served. But critics of the program say the state is exploiting prisoners' eagerness to earn time for early release. Well, the Democracy Now! Team traveled to the Delta Conservation Camp about an hour north of San Francisco Sunday to a low-security prison where more than 100 men are imprisoned. We interviewed incarcerated firefighters who had just returned from a 24-hour shift fighting the Snell Fire in Napa County. We spoke to them under the close surveillance of prison administrators. I began by talking to some of the officials from the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation.
My Sergeant Reeder, I'm the Assistant Camp Commander at this camp.
And what fire did they just come in from?
They came up from the Snell Fire.
And where is the Snell Fire?
It's southeast of Middletown.
And how long has it been burning?
Yesterday afternoon. Huh. It started, I think, about 3 o'clock yesterday, and it went up to 1,700 acres by like 8 o'clock last night.
And how important are these fire camps of incarcerated people to fighting fires in California?
The inmate firefighters are the backbone of CAL FIRE. They get the toughest assignment there is out there.
What's the toughest assignment?
Whatever they're asked to do. Usually it's cutting line where a dozer can't go. Hmm. So they get the toughest assignments in the worst conditions, 110 degrees in the middle of the sun, wearing 2 layers of clothing, carrying 40 pounds of gear. And then they have to carry all their food and water for a 24-hour shift. Mm. And then swing a tool the whole time.
And you're saying they do the toughest jobs?
They get the toughest assignments there is.
Mm. How much do they get paid?
$1 an hour.
So the state is really dependent on these prisoner firefighters?
Definitely, yes. They save a lot of money for the state.
You know about how much?
I've heard anywhere from $60 to $100 million a year.
My name is Tracy Snyder. I'm a correctional captain with CDCR, California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation.
And talk about what happens here. How often do they fight fires? How often are they just here at camp?
So obviously, fighting fires, that's unpredictable. Last year was one of our biggest fire seasons. 2015 was another big fire season. Last year, obviously, fire season lasted for somewhere around 6 to 8 months. The Santa Rosa fire, the Napa fire, these guys responded to that. The Thomas Fire down in Southern California.
Would you call these men heroes?
I would, yes. They do an excellent job for the state of California. When you see the devastation in Santa Rosa and Napa last year and Montecito down in Southern California with the Thomas Fire, these guys, as the sergeant said, they're the backbone. They do a great job, and I appreciate them.
After the returning firefighters have breakfast, I sit down with a few of them under the watchful eye of prison officials.
My name is Dante Youngblood. I came to camp 14 months ago. Hmm. I've been in jail 9 years.
How much more time do you have to serve?
One more year.
So talk about the work you do here. Are you risking your life?
I guess you could say you're risking your life, yes, but you're not really in life-threatening situations. 95% of the time, you're not in a life-threatening situation. You in a controlled environment. You know, if you've been doing it for a while, you know what to do. But it's a hard job, for sure, because we got to cut line. The fire could be right there, and then we'd be cutting lines on the fires to stop it from coming.
What do you mean cutting line?
Well, we cut a line with a McLeod.
What is a McLeod?
It's a tool. It's a tool. It's like something like a hoe, yep. Like you're using in your garden. And we cut line with it, 4-foot line, to stop the fire from coming.
So you've had the fire as close as like a couple of feet from where we are?
Yes.
Is it scary?
Well, I guess it gets scary. It used to, when you first started, you would be scary. Some of the inmates, some of the other people would be scary, some of the crew members, but it's, to me, no, it's not. It's just regular to me. To me, it's just regular work. I didn't already program myself to just, whenever we go, we just go. It's just, it don't even bother me. It's just all right. It's just work. It's work that we're doing.
Last night, one of the guys fell down the hill?
Yes.
What happened?
Well, it's slippery. Rocks and slippery. He didn't feel that bad. It just was a little fall. He just sprained his ankle or something. But it happens. It do happen. Trees fall on you. Mm-hmm. All of that. Like the last fire we was at, I think, a month ago, a firefighter died. Free firefighter. Because the tree fell on him. That's how it goes. It gets crazy out there sometimes, but most of the time, we know what's going on.
Are you shoulder to shoulder with the Cal Fire firefighters?
Yes. Yeah, we cut line together. We be out there. We're not split up from them. Like, we're not like, oh, bring the inmates over here and them. Nah, it's not like that. We all out there together. We all out there helping each other. Like, if I walk by one and I see a Cal Fire or any firefighter and he need help or something with the hose or something like that, I help him. Because they'll help us, too. We all here to help each other and make sure everybody's safe.
How much money do you make?
$1 an hour.
When you're fighting the fire?
Yes, when you're fighting the fire, $1 an hour.
So how, for example, last night, how long were you fighting the fire?
Probably 20-something hours. So we probably made $20, $22, $24.
What do you think of that?
Well, I think we should make, of course I would say anybody that got a job, you would think you should make more. I thought we was getting $2 until I came to fire camp. But, you know, it's cool, though. I mean, we making money for something that we'll probably do for free anyway, just for the time cut. So it's all right. But I would prefer, yes, we get more money. Of course, anybody in a working position will want to make more money.
So you're saving the state, to say the least, a lot of money. Some say it's something like $100 million a year.
I don't know. I mean, of course that, I'm sure, but, you know, I mean, we look at it as getting the time. The time cut is more than the money to us. We'd rather make the money for sure because we can still send money to our families. We still send money home, but, yeah, we only make $1 an hour on the fires.
So how old were you when you first went to prison?
It was 9 years ago. I think I was 27. Mm-hmm.
Did you want to talk about what happened?
Nah. Uh-huh. I just made bad choices.
Has being here at the camp changed your thinking about the world?
Yes. I mean, I could say I've learned a lot, just that I can do more than what I used to do, that I can do right, I can do better things with my life and then just commit crime and do things like that. I figured out I can do a job. I could work. I never had a job a day in my life. I never cashed a check. Literally, I ain't never cashed a check in my life. I ain't never used a credit card. It's crazy. I just sound like I'm from the mountains or something.
What made you decide to do this interview? It's the first time you've talked to a journalist?
Because I might want to go to Hollywood and be an actor or something. I want to see if I can do it. I'm serious. Plus, I wanted y'all to get our perspective. Because I know you can hear from the guards, from the captains. And then I know a lot of people here probably don't want to do the interview, probably scared, or just don't want to do it, but I'm not. I do whatever I want to do.
Can you vote?
No felons.
Can you vote?
No felons can vote.
You know, that's interesting, because in Vermont and Maine, they can vote from jail.
No felons can vote in California.
Would you like to see that change?
Yes. But we can't talk about it.
This is, guys.
Camp.
Okay.
Camp only.
Okay.
Voting politics.
Yep.
Okay.
Camp only.
Let me tell you the reason I asked that is that in Vermont.
At this point in the interview, Sergeant Reeder steps in to end the conversation with Dante, telling us political questions aren't allowed. Later, the commander comes over.
Yes, I'm Lieutenant Sid Turner. I'm the camp commander here at Delta Conservation Camp.
Talk about how hard this work is.
This is for an inmate in the state of California. This is the hardest work that you're going to find when they're out there on the line, doing the work that they're expected to do. It's extremely physically demanding. The hours can be exhausting at times. For example, last year when we had the Napa fires, they were actually out for 3 days straight because the resources within the state were so tapped that it took that long just to get them relieved and off the lines.
And they make just a dollar an hour fighting these fires next to Cal Fire firefighters?
That is correct, but understand there's a big difference between Cal Fire firefighters and an inmate firefighter.
Do you think they should be paid more, the prisoners?
I believe that they should make more than the dollar an hour. They've been at that rate of pay for many decades now at this point in time.
So it seems like the state would be threatened if if people's time was even cut, or if as a result of overcrowded prisons, more prisoners were released. Of course, they would be the prisoners who had the lowest sentences, and those are exactly the prisoners who get into these kinds of camps. They'd lose that kind of labor, the firefighting labor.
Potentially, very much so. There is definitely a need for this type of a resource, the hand crews to go out and cut line in areas that aren't accessible to equipment such as bulldozers and things of that type. So California needs hand crews. If we don't have the inmates to perform that function, then they got to find the labor from someplace else.
Sergeant Reeder, do you think the prisoners should be paid more for fighting fires?
Yes.
They're doing the same work as Cal Fire, the firefighters who are free.
I think we do harder work. I think we get the harder assignments. Nobody else can touch us.
The question of how much California relies on prison labor, particularly when it comes to fighting wildfires, came under scrutiny in 2014. Lawyers in the state attorney general's office argued in federal court that a program to parole more prisoners would drain the state's source of cheap labor. The California attorney general at the time was, well, now U.S. Senator Kamala Harris. She later said lawyers in her office argued the case without her knowledge. Harris said the idea of incarcerating people as a source of labor evokes images of chain gangs. I sit down with another prisoner who just came back from fighting the Snell fire.
My name is Marty Vinson. I'm 25 years old, and I came to this camp about mid-July this year.
What has been the most difficult fire that you've fought?
At first, I wanted to say at Eel River when I went to Detwater last year. Detwater was a pretty bad fire, but the river fire this year at Delta, I think, topped it, because it was the most, like, I guess, harm's way I've been in. It was a situation where we was back burning, and they had this one of our saw teams, which was my saw and me, bumped down with crew three to cut on the other side on the green to where if there are emberms coming across, it's still pushed back more to where it just doesn't catch. And it led to a point where it flared up more than it had to on the fire that I was burning. And when it did that, it jumped the line. So when it jumped the line, mind you, the puller I left out, we carry a gallon of gas on our back. So when that happened, we pretty much immediately have to run down the mountain. And as we ran down the mountain, we ran into the highway. As we ran into the highway, one of the captains escorted us down the street. But as we was going down the street, now the fire jumped from where it was burning at, where it was supposed to burn at, to the green across the road. And within seconds, the whole highway went from a nice bright day to just dark smoke and fire everywhere. So we had to run as far pretty much down that highway until it was green again. And then as it continued to burn and the black was there and it was safe to go back, we actually had to walk back in there. So just being put in a bad predicament like that, to where that adrenaline is really pumping and, you know, you try to figure out the best thing to do because possibly your life is on the line. I would want to say the river fire this year was the worst one for me.
Do you think of yourself as a hero?
I like to look at myself as somebody that I want to be here for whoever, like whoever needs me, I want to be there for them. Just last night on this fire, we had somebody who came back not too long ago where the terrain of where we was climbing up, cutting line, there was just too many loose boulders. And, you know, we always try to, you know, do what we have to do, but still provide safety while doing it. And it's just one of those situations where it's no one's fault, but it happens. And while there's cutting line, a boulder actually fell and hit him. And he popped something in his knee, and it just swelled up. And it came to a point where we didn't really have no answer to it. What are we going to do? How are we going to get him out here? It's night. They don't do no airlifts at night. They don't want nothing in the air at night. So it led to the possibility of us just bedding down at the bottom of this creek and wait till like morning. And it was just something where it's a natural thing about me. I want to be there for people. So I just volunteered and said, well, look, me personally, I don't feel like it's relevant for us to stay down here. So I just volunteered to take my pack off and carry him up the mountain.
So you carried him up from below near the creek?
Yes. The first part was maybe the worst part. It was real steep. A lot of people didn't think it would actually happen like that, but it was something that I just pushed myself to say I'm going to do, and I got it done. We went going straight uphill to having to go side hill, which that was another, you know, cautious area because the road was probably like 2 feet wide. So it was something, it took its time. It went from 2 a.m. to like almost 5 a.m, but we got him up there, and now he's back here. Mm.
You're risking your life here.
It's exactly what's going on. Everything we do, you know, no one's really promised to come back.
And how much do you make?
$1 an hour.
When you're fighting a fire?
When you're fighting a fire, $1 an hour. When you're on typical grade, you make $1.45 a day.
Some have called it slave labor. What do you think of that?
I don't really want to call the work slave work, but I feel like it's their whole mentality and what they're thinking about at the end of the day. No matter what, regardless if we're incarcerated or we're free, we're getting paid $1 an hour.
That was Marty Vinson, an incarcerated firefighter at the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation's Delta Conservation Camp, low-security prison camp in Fairfield, California, where more than 100 incarcerated firefighters are housed. They earn $1 an hour for fighting California wildfires, saving the state $100 million per year. Special thanks to Democracy Now!'s Libby Rainey, John Hamilton, Carla Wills, Ariel Boone, and Mike Burke for that report. When we come back, we'll be joined by Amika Mota. She, too, fought fires when she was incarcerated. Stay with us. If you hear me by Tupac here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. We are broadcasting from San Francisco, the site of this week's Global Climate Action Summit. I'm Amy Goodman. We continue our conversation about California's incarcerated firefighters with a look at the women fighting the state's climate change-fueled blazes. We're joined now by Amika Mota, former prisoner firefighter. She didn't even make $1 an hour while on duty as a firefighter. She made just 53 cents. Amika is now the director of prison reentry at the Young Women's Freedom Center in San Francisco. Welcome to Democracy Now!
Thank you for having me.
Well, I'm sure this brought back many memories for you as you saw these young men talking about their experience just yesterday and the day before fighting fires here in California. How did you end up fighting fires in California in prison?
I was incarcerated. I began my prison sentence in 2008, and about 5 years into my sentence, I became eligible for fire camp. So I had always kind of had my eye on wanting to make it to be a prison firefighter.
What makes you able to make it to get to these prison camps?
So you have to be a certain level of security clearance. And so I started off at a level 3 security, and I had to work my way down into a level 2. So it has to do with security risk, your supervision level, your behavior in prison, and the crime that you committed to land there. Mm-hmm.
And so talk about where you ended up.
So I ended up at CCWF, which is in Chowchilla, California. It's a prison in one of the 3 women's prisons in California. And ended up at CCWF, which has a firehouse, fire department, that has a mutual aid agreement with Madera County, the county that the prison is situated in. And it's a small firehouse, similar.
So this is different than a fire camp.
This is different than a fire camp, yes. Chowchilla is unique in that sense that they have this institutional fire department where we respond to fires that are happening inside the institution and also within a 30-mile radius of the prison.
So people's homes.
People's
it might not
homes.
Be a wildfire.
Oh, no. We do structure fires, vehicle fires, car accidents, medical calls in people's homes. We do a whole variety of things, so not just wild and firefighting.
So what was your experience like? You're a team of all women.
Team of all women, yes.
You go on a fire truck to someone's house on fire.
Yes, yes. And we are well trained to get the job done when we're there. We're trained up as part of our initiation into the firehouse. We do about 6 weeks of training of just the physical pieces of it and learning how to use the equipment and ride on the truck, all the pieces of the
truck. And where did you live?
We lived in a firehouse that sat right outside the prison gates. So, we were looking inside the prison the whole time. But we came home to what was called a firehouse, but we were still under supervision. We were still incarcerated and still...
And how much did you make fighting these fires?
I made about 53 cents an hour. My total check per month was about somewhere around $64, I believe. And I was one of the highest paid at the fire department. So the other women that I worked side by side with were making about 38 cents an hour.
Some might be listening and saying, well, wow, you got incredible training to be a firefighter. Yeah. So you get out of prison. Can you become a firefighter?
No. I cannot become a firefighter in a municipal fire department. Most of those require EMS certifications, and as felons, we are blocked from getting that certification, although we were performing those duties while we were incarcerated.
Wait, explain.
Well, we responded to calls, to medical calls in people's homes. We weren't EMS certified, right, but we were first responders.
But explain why you can't, what this rationale of because you're a felon.
I think you can
do it when you're in prison, right, but not out of prison?
Yes. I don't understand that rationale. I wish I could say I did. I think that there's occupational licensing issues that prevent us from continuing the work when we come home. And then there's also a stigma of being a formerly incarcerated person when we come home. So they will use us when we're on the inside. But on the outside, I think there's a whole different level of explaining to do when you might have somebody riding on a fire truck or responding into someone's home about criminal history.
When you had been in prison for years and this all-woman crew goes in and saves people's lives, saves houses, you're putting out fires, did the homeowners, did the people you save, did they know you were prisoners?
Some of them did. Some of the folks that were in the small communities next to the prison would see a fire truck full of women and know it was the fire girls is what they called us. But most people didn't. You know, we didn't wear gear that distinguished us as inmate firefighters. We wore normal turnouts and wild and gear. So we looked like every other firefighter out on scene. So responding to a car accident on Highway 99, nobody would know that we were in my firefighters.
Amika, how do you respond to some people saying this is slave labor? The prisons will say this is voluntary. Yeah. You didn't have to fight the fire.
There's a level to that that may be true, but voluntary. So folks that are there with the incentive of earning good time credit are trying to make it home to their families, and there is no other option in prison to earn as much good time credit. So incentivizing this job is the only way that folks can get home to their families. I'm not sure that that is voluntary. I think that, you know, even if you're there and you're not earning good time credit, I, for instance, did not earn good time credit. I was not eligible for that. So my incentive for being a firefighter was different. But, you know, I think it's really, it was really emotional actually watching that, because I kept thinking, a dollar an hour, you know, there's the basic things that we need to survive in prison. We need hygiene, we need deodorant and soap and coffee, or, you know, the things that we need to buy in prison that are not provided for us. Tampons is one of those. So there's those basic costs that we need to cover while earning, you know, while working a prison job. But we also have families outside that have these expenses of the phone calls that we, you know, call home on, or the visits to come see us, taking care of our children. And we also leave with massive court fines and fees, right? And so there is, to me, the idea that there is no mechanism for us to kind of start writing some of those things and supporting our families and paying off the debt that we will leave with.
So many of you come from poverty, and you then learn this remarkable skill, clearly one that is so needed in California right now.
Yes.
With these massive climate change-fueled fires. And you are forced back into poverty afterwards.
Yes.
These are actually well-paying jobs if you are not a prisoner.
Right, absolutely. I think that's a pretty devastating piece of it, is that you know, this is an opportunity for folks coming home to have a real sustainable living wage and a career rather than a minimum wage job, which, you know, we're trying to take care of our families. And so, yeah, it's pretty devastating that we can't come home and funnel ourselves into something that we've been doing, that we may love, that we may be really good at.
You were sometimes saving the lives and homes of the guards' families?
Absolutely. You know, I remember a Christmas Eve fire at a correctional officer's home. We were doing our best to save that holiday for that family. I remember responding to a vehicle accident with a correctional officer's daughter and granddaughter, you know, and extricating them from the car, preparing them to life flight out. And yeah, we were basically, you know, so many correctional officers lived in the community that we responded in, that we were serving our jailers, really. And we were doing it proudly.
And the idea that the California Attorney General's lawyers fought in 2014 against the release of prisoners, talking about how much money they save the state?
Right. So when we talk about slave labor and we talk about policy like that, I think that speaks for itself. You know, the idea of hanging on to this force, this labor force, and not allowing us to return home to our families and not allowing us to serve our time and be done. It's crazy.
Are you trying to change the law that says that as an ex-felon, you can't be a firefighter? You can't do the job that you were trained to do?
Yes, absolutely. We've been working on a number of bills that address occupational licensing, the EMS certification in particular here in California. Unfortunately, that bill was gutted and has turned into a study bill at this point. And there is another bill that we're working on that has it's moving forward. And that addresses kind of the broader issue of how far back we can look at someone's criminal history.
Were you surprised to hear the officers at the prison camp? I mean, you wouldn't know this was a prison if you were driving down the road because it said Delta Conservation Corps area, but it is a prison.
Yeah.
Were you surprised to hear the officers at the camp saying, yes, they should make more money? They are doing the most dangerous parts of this very dangerous job, which is fighting wildfires.
Right. I'm not surprised because they are the ones that see us work. They work most closely with us. They see how hard we work, and they know that there's something wrong with that picture. Hmm. Yeah, we hear often that we're the hardest workers out there.
Again, that place we were, that we just went to, the previous piece we did, the Delta Conservation Camp, it's called. Now, Amika, Governor Brown appointed you to the State Advisory Committee on Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, and you're prison reentry director at Young Women's Freedom Center here in San Francisco. As we wrap up, talk about what you're doing with these young women. How do you help them the most coming from prison, and what are you doing at the state level for Governor Brown?
Well, we at the Young Women's Freedom Center are building a movement across the state of California of formerly incarcerated and system-involved women and girls to work on policy and advocacy issues that directly affect us. I think that, you know, on the state advisory board, I am a voice for those women. So, you know, women and girls that are involved in the juvenile justice system. And so always continuing to bring voices to the table of the folks that are most impacted by these policies.
And congratulations on your little infant daughter who you brought today.
Thank you so much.
3 months old?
Yes, Gloria.
Well, I thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Amika Mota is a former prisoner firefighter, now director of prison reentry at the Young Women's Freedom Center here in San Francisco. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report, as we broadcast this week from the Global Climate Action Summit. We're going to speak with the investigative reporter Antonia Yuhas about death on the Dakota Access Pipeline. Stay with us. First Cry by Sharon Birch here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. We are broadcasting from San Francisco, the site of this week's Global Climate Action Summit. I'm Amy Goodman. Thousands, tens of thousands of people marched here in San Francisco Saturday to demand action on climate, jobs, and justice as they kicked off the Rise Against Climate Capitalism conference, a counter-conference to California Governor Jerry Brown's Global Climate Action Summit. Today, the conference will highlight the common goals of climate activists and labor. That's also the focus of an explosive new report headlined Death on the Dakota Access, an investigation into the deadly business of building oil and gas pipelines. published today in the Pacific Standard magazine. It looks at the deaths of two men who worked on DAPL, that's the Dakota Access Pipeline, and the massive oil and natural gas boom that's generated some of the deadliest jobs in the country. For more, we're joined by the report's author, Antonia Yuhas, longtime oil and energy journalist. Her books include Black Tide, The Devastating Impact of the Gulf Oil Spill, and The Tyranny of Oil, the world's most powerful industry, and What We Must Do to Stop It. Welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us, Antonia.
Thanks for having me, Amy.
So talk about why you began this piece, why you started this investigation, death and Dakota Access.
Yeah, I'd been covering Standing Rock for some time, and I was actually doing an interview with LaDonna Brave Bull Allard in Standing Rock. And she told me that back in 2014, when she first learned of Dakota Access Pipeline, she knew she was going to oppose it. And the reason why she told me was, no one is going to build an oil pipeline over my son's grave because of how close it would pass to where her son was buried. That death got me to thinking about the pipeline itself as a source of injury and harm and death, not just spills that might come from it and have, or leaks, or where it was being built, but then the people involved in building it. And I started looking at construction and learned of the death of a young man who was building the Dakota Access Pipeline, Nicholas Jonasich, 27 years old. And his death is reported by the AP. I started to dig into what had happened to him. And as I started doing that, investigating, I learned that just 3 days later, at the opposite end of the pipeline, another worker building the Dakota Access Pipeline had died during the construction. So then I said, I need to learn more about oil and gas pipeline construction, and went to the Bureau of Labor Statistics to look at fatality rate data, because I'd already learned that the drilling of oil and natural gas, so the extraction workers, has been found to be one of the deadliest jobs in America, with fatality rates as high as 7 times the national average. So I went to see what were the fatality rates for oil and gas pipeline construction workers, only to learn that they had never been run. The Bureau of Labor Statistics had never run that data. They didn't even start counting deaths in the sector until 2003. So I pulled the data together myself. With instruction from Bureau of Labor Statistics, I figured out how to run the fatality rate data myself, and learned that building oil and natural gas pipelines is also among one of the deadliest jobs in America, and that in 2016, they had a fatality rate of 3.6 times the national job average, and they too had reached highs of 7 times the national average at their highest points. So these are deadly jobs, and a deadly job sector that hasn't been exposed or discussed as such.
So tell us how Nicholas Jonasich died.
So this took some finding out, because he had died alone. One of the things that makes building oil and natural gas pipelines increasingly more dangerous is, one, the pace at which they're being built to keep up with the boom in oil and natural gas production, which is a result of the boom in fracking. And North Dakota is the heart of this. So they're being built at an extremely fast pace and clip, but also at much further distances from towns or city centers, very, very rural areas, and exceptionally more so. So he's out towards the top of the Dakota Access Pipeline near Tioga, North Dakota, and he's alone. So I had to piece together from interviews with police through a Freedom of Information Act request, a lot of investigation, what happened. And what happened was, we think, he was working at the very tail end, what should be one of the safest parts of pipeline construction. And he'd never done it before. He was only 3 weeks into the job. But he was at the part where the pipeline's in the ground, the dirt's been laid over it, and he is resoiling the area. He's driving a tractor. And something goes wrong with the tractor. He gets out to fix it on his own, rather than waiting to have a repair person fix it, because that probably, the logic being, that would cost money, and you don't want to cost the company money. He fixes it himself. There's no manual in the tractor. And we also learned that the tractor had been jerry-rigged by the company that owned it to make it work differently than it was designed to work.
He gets out, and this tractor is actually has a piece of equipment on it called the Ripper, which has scythe-like blades that rip through the dirt. He sticks something into the Ripper. The spring recoils back and hits him in the skull, fracturing his skull. He gets back into the tractor, slumps over the tractor, and happens to be discovered by his foreman, who's driving another worker to another job site and notices his tractor sitting idle. And he dies less than 24 hours later at a small hospital in Minot, North Dakota.
And who is he working for?
So this is the part that then becomes sort of the mystery of how you even connect worker injury and death to pipelines, because the pipeline companies have taken advantage of loopholes in corporate construct—the way that a company can be composed that have allowed for a great distancing between the person doing the work and the company that runs the pipeline, making it often very difficult to even identify a death or injury with the pipeline that they're working on. So Nicholas, known as Nick J to his friends, is working a temporary employee hired through his union for Indian Head Pipeline Services, which is a subcontractor to Precision Pipeline, which is a subcontractor to Dakota Access LLC. Dakota Access LLC is the developer of a company that is owned by Energy Transfer Partners, which is itself a subset of Energy Transfer Equity, which is itself a subset of a company called LEGP LLC. That's just one set of companies associated with this pipeline, because the Dakota Access Pipeline is part of the larger Bakken pipeline system, which carries the oil first from North Dakota to Illinois, then from Illinois to Texas. The Bakken pipeline system, I could spend the next 20 minutes going through the companies that own the Bakken pipeline system, none of which were then associated with the deaths of Nicholas Janisch, and then the second death that I uncovered, which had not been previously reported as associated with DAPL, because it wasn't known that it was associated with DAPL. Troy Dolan was hired by Precision, and those are the only companies named in the deaths of those workers.
And what happened very quickly to Troy Dolan?
Troy Dolan was working at the other end of the pipeline. He essentially had been suffering from heat stroke all day long. It was very clear that he had been. He was never sent home. He was never told not to work. He was put in a position of flagger, which is the moving of the equipment to and from the job site, the DAPL construction site. And he apparently went to go seek shade underneath a massive lowboy truck trailer and probably passed out. And the truck driver pulled forward, not knowing he was there, and ran him over and killed him.
They were both buried. They don't know each other. They're working at opposite ends of the pipeline on the same day.
That's right. September 2nd, 2016, their funerals were both held. And, you know, what I found in interviewing pipeline workers who Evan Whitford with LIUNA, the Laborers International Union of North America, which is the largest union representing Dakota Access Pipeline workers, was that, you know, there is a tremendous sense of necessity of security and protection for their workers. Like most oil sector workers, many of these people are former veterans who came back. When they came back, they liked the teamwork of this type of work. They understand that there's danger involved, but they also say this work has gotten much more dangerous. And then there is concern that it's more dangerous still under the Trump administration because of the rollback in the already weak protections.
And I can only think of September 2nd, 2016. That's the day we arrived. Democracy Now! Arrived in North Dakota, September 3rd being the day of the dogs, when Dakota Access Pipeline guards unleashed dogs on the Native American water protectors who were protesting the destruction of their sacred ground. All of this converging. But you mentioned Trump, and I wanted to turn to May of last year, when now President Trump travels to Mandan, North Dakota, where he celebrates his decision to pull out of the landmark 2015 climate deal while speaking outside an oil refinery.
In order to protect American industry and workers, we withdrew the United States from the job-killing Paris Climate Accord. Job killer. People have no idea. Many people have no idea how bad that was. And right here in North Dakota, the Dakota Access Pipeline is finally open for business.
So that's President Trump in Mandan. And Antonia Yuhas notes that standing at Trump's side was fracking king Harold Hamm, the so-called Baron of the Bakken, chief executive officer of Continental Resources, one of the Bakken's largest producers.
That's right.
Antonia.
Harold Hamm was referred to before and after the election as Trump's energy whisperer. He has some of the largest holdings in the Bakken and the most invested in getting that oil out of North Dakota, because the problem faced by producers in North Dakota was that deregulation and the onset of fracking allowed for this massive boom, a 10 times increase from 2006 to 2016, 10 times of oil production in North Dakota, but they were having trouble getting it out of the state. So the pipeline was a necessity for Hamm, and while it, of course, began during the Obama administration, it was significantly slowed down at the end of that administration. But one of the very first things that Trump did was sign an executive order as soon as he came into office, authorizing completion of the pipeline. As soon as it was done, it served its purpose, and production increased even more so dramatically again in North Dakota after the pipeline was completed. And for Harold Hamm, that led to a significant increase in production in the state, in the value of his stock, in literally a reduction in the cost of every single barrel of oil that he produces everywhere, and his very first shipments ever of oil to China.
And you have a sub-piece within your larger piece, Trump and Friends Cash In. Members and backers of the Trump administration are profiting from DAPL while scheming to make even bigger bucks shipping oil and petrochemicals overseas. You have Harold Hamm, you have Kelsey Warren,
the CEO of Energy Transfer Partners, a major backer of the Trump campaign, and then, of course, the immediate, probably largest beneficiary of the completion of the Dakota Access Pipeline. Actually, Kelsey Warren had first backed Rick Perry for president with a $5 million investment in Perry's campaign. Perry was on the board of Energy Transfer Partners, then became energy secretary, a position from which he significantly advanced the completion of pipelines.
And Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross.
So Wilbur Ross is, I think, a critically important piece of all of these players. Ross, first, he was known as the king of bankruptcy. His main area is going in, finding bankrupt companies, turning them over to make a profit. In the Bakken, many of these small companies had been suffering before DAPL was completed and were going into bankruptcy, and a lot of companies came in to make money off of this, including Wilbur Ross's companies. But he looked forward, and he's also heavily invested in shipping, the shipping of oil and natural gas and petrochemicals through Navigator and Diamond S. His companies are set up to partner with Energy Transfer Partners, which is not only building pipelines, but is building infrastructure to convert that oil and natural gas into petrochemicals to make plastics, and then ship that product overseas, including through Wilbur Ross's companies, with contracts that are already signed for China. So what the companies are seeing, including ExxonMobil, so Rex Tillerson, former Secretary of State, former head of ExxonMobil, is one of the Trumpers who cash in, is all this work that we're seeing through the Global Climate Action Summit and Rise for Climate Justice. One of the end goals is to see a reduction in fossil fuels for use of energy and use of transportation. Well, the companies are seeing this too, and they're looking forward to petrochemicals. And ExxonMobil alone is predicting, or is invested in, a $20 billion investment in petrochemical infrastructure. Wilbur Ross's companies are predicting, former companies now, a $100 billion
increase. We have 20 seconds, and you'd like to see water pipelines built.
That's right. So the solution is the building of oil and natural gas pipelines, incredibly dangerous work. What we really need in the United States is a massive investment in water pipeline construction. Same job skills, same unions. Those same workers can build water pipelines.
Well, we're going to do part two of this and post on democracynow.org. Antonia Yuhas, oil and energy journalist, will link to her latest piece in the Pacific Standard headline, Death on the Dakota Access. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.